Hey everybody, welcome back to the second video of the ValueU University introduction. My name is Colton Carnevale, and for everybody who's just joining us for this video and who didn't watch the video last week, we highly recommend going to watch the video, but let's go ahead and do a reintroduction of everybody. Chuck, why don't we start with you?
Hi everybody, I'm Chuck Carnevale, aka Mr. Valuation. I'm the co-founder of FastGraphs, the Fundamentals Analyzer software tool. I've published numerous articles on various websites like Forbes and Seeking Alpha, et cetera, and I'm very passionate about bringing the message of investing at fair value to the public.
Bill, let's go to you now.
Yes, I'm William Kay. I go by Bill, and I do teach at the University of Missouri, Kansas City as an adjunct professor. I teach a lot of finance and accounting courses and work at a community college and work directly with corporations teaching finance and accounting, and love teaching the subject.
And finally, you, Nathan.
Hi, I'm Nathan Mock. I'm an associate professor of finance at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. I teach graduate and undergraduate classes on a range of topics, but mainly valuation and corporate finance. And so my research tends to follow the exact same type of topics. So this is very much of great interest to me, and I'm looking forward to chatting about this.
Awesome. So yeah, last week we talked a little bit about introductions to investing, and we wanted to kick this week's discussion off with a question for you, Chuck. How can I tell if a stock is selling at a fair price?
Well, thanks, Colin. I'm probably aging myself here. It used to be an old TV show called the $64,000 question, and that probably is the $64,000 question. Maybe now it's $64 million with inflation. But anyway, the bottom line is there are a lot of, valuation is a puzzle. I think the first thing we have to understand about valuation is it can never be done with perfect precision. It always needs to be done within a range. And there are lots of metrics, primarily earnings and cash flows, free cash flows, EBITDA, things like that, that you can utilize. You can also look at price to sales, price to book. And we're going to be talking extensively about that throughout the course here. And it's something I'm looking forward to bringing some more clarity to. But the reality of it is you're trying to position yourself so that you're an owner, shareholder of the business. And fair value simply means that you're participating fully in what that business is capable of generating on your behalf as an operating company.
And Nathan, what about you? Do you have any comments on how to tell if a stock is selling at a fair price?
Yeah, one of the cool things about stocks is you can observe the actual price very easily. Any number of places you can go and find the price. The question of, is it a fair price, as Chuck said, is quite a bit less clear. But I think with the sort of right view of the way that value works and that a firm's fundamentals relate to what the price should be, we can start to get a sense of if the current market price makes sense or not for us. And I just add that really what you're trying to invest in is what a firm will do, what they're capable of doing in terms of generating cash. And so figuring out whether or not you're paying a fair price is really a matter of figuring out what kind of cash that firm is going to generate, and then trying to figure out what a reasonable price for that is. And that's really what a lot of our discussion and curriculum is going to be based on, is doing exactly that.
So Bill, before you answer that question, I actually want to tie it into the next question. Nathan brought up talking about cash flows and, what the company will do, because, you can't invest in the past, you can only invest in the future. So part of about telling how a stock is a fair price, it's also understanding what the business is. So what does someone need to know about a company before investing in it and, ultimately determining the fair price of that company?
Yes. When you're buying a business, you're investing in a business, it's like anything else. You've got to look at what are their products and services, what's their management team. We can look at their financial statements, which are their scorecards. How did they do in the past? What are their trends? I always like to look at, is a business generating a profit? Are they growing their profits? Are they growing their earnings over time? So important. So are the sales going up? Are the profits going up? But profitability is only part of it. I mean, we have to turn that profit into cash. We have to collect the money from the customer. And are we generating positive cash flow from our basic operations? What are we doing with it? Are we investing it for growth of the company in the future, buying capital expenditures? improving the business. And then it comes down to the financial health on one day. We look at that balance sheet. What do they own according to accounting? What do they owe? And what's the difference? So the debt to equity, the solvency of a company. And the credit rating comes from a lot from the profitability, the cash flow, and the financial health. So those are the things I like to look at. Return on assets, return on equity, and the price, the PE of a company. Is it overvalued right now? Undervalued? And that's why FastGraphs, I think, is a wonderful tool that helps me look at these different factors.
So we keep talking about cash, and you know, there's the old saying that cash is king, but profitability is also somewhat just as important as cash. So Chuck, what are some of your favorite metrics to look at, you know, before you invest in a company other than just profitability? And, you know, is it just profitability and cash, or are there some additional things you'd like to look at as well?
Well, you know, as I mentioned earlier, there's a lot of metrics I like to look at, but I think one thing that might help the viewer to kind of understand this concept is to recognize when you're talking about price and you're talking about value, you're also kind of describing how the market works. You know, the stock market is actually an auction. It's where, you know, where people are, you know, bidding on buying a stock and people are asking a price to sell the stock. So there's this constant, you know, auction going on, and price from that aspect actually relates to the company's to the liquidity. One of the great advantages of the stock market over, say, even something as a good an investment as real estate is that the market's liquid. You can always, you know, liquidate your shares. You, if you own a house and you're renting out the house, you can't sell the kitchen. You either got to sell the whole house or whatever. If you own stocks, you can sell a piece of it. But then the other aspect of that is the value of the business itself. And that's what ultimately gives it its value. So from that perspective, you're thinking about being an owner of a business, and you know, you're thinking about things like Bill mentioned, the assets, the profitability, the products and services they sell, and you're focusing more on that. Price can be misleading. Markets can misappraise stocks over the short run because of the liquidity. So the good news is stocks are liquid. The bad news is stocks are liquid. You know, there are times when the stock will the market will get real pessimistic and undervalue your stock. And I always refer to those as not necessarily you're losing money if the fundamentals are good, which is where the value is. If the company's business, as Bill mentioned, is growing and profitable and generating cash flows and growing their revenues, well, the business is doing fine. It's just that you don't have liquidity in that business. You can't sell that business for theoretically what it's worth. So the real difference between price and value is price may not reflect the value, the underlying value of the business, where value is where you're really looking at the fundamentals. And, you know, having a perspective of both of those things simultaneously, as we do with FastGraphs, we'll be talking about that a lot, is critical, because now you can look at value and price. And therefore, if the market's overpriced in the stock, you can be aware of that. If the market's undervaluing the stock, you can be aware of it as well.
And Nathan, do you have any extra comments on the difference between value and price that Chuck started talking about there?
Yeah, I think Chuck nailed it there on value and price. You know, the thing about price, I said this in the first time around too, is, you know, we know what the price is. We don't know what the value is. That's what we have to estimate. And so the better we can get at estimating what the real worth of the firm is based on the cash that they're going to generate, I think that gives us the best chance to make good decisions. And sometimes the key to that is just really understanding at a really simple and fundamental level how a firm generates cash. So you know that they generate cash, but you know, as others, as Bill have said and Chuck said, you know, products and services, but why do their customers choose them? You know, what is it that gives them an edge? And that allows you to really adjust your expectations with news. And it also allows you to look a little bit into the future and try to see if it makes sense what folks are projecting the firm to generate in terms of cash and see if that matches your own analysis. And I think that can give a person a lot of confidence to stick with their own value, even as the price may move all over the place. And it might send different signals. You need something that's a little more stable than that. And I think a process to value is that kind of stabilizing force.
And Bill, do you have any comments on price?
Well, I agree with all these statements. And it's so true. You know, when I invest in a business, I want to make sure it's going to be around in the future. And some businesses do prosper. They go forward. They make more money. It's great. You stick with those. Other companies, maybe the management doesn't see the future and doesn't You look at, we talked about Sears last time. They could have had a great future if they'd have moved their catalog to the internet and become the Amazon, but for some reason they didn't, and it was probably a ship you wanted to get off of before it sunk. So you got to keep your eyes open, and as I said, your eye on the ball. Things change.
So since we're talking a lot about price and value right now, like you guys are saying, there's a large difference between price and value. Price is what, Chuck, this is something you always say, price is what you pay, value is what you get. I want to explore the idea of, people tend to always think that when something is overvalued, you know, Chuck, I've seen it in your articles specifically, that when you say something's overvalued, people are expecting that it should just drop precipitously immediately. I want to explore the idea that just because you're paying for something overvalued doesn't mean that the stock price is immediately going to drop. You know, you could still make some money in it, but you are paying for a lot more risk than, you know, you would be for a comparable investment that is undervalued. So I wanted to just pick your brain a little bit about that concept and see what you have to say about that, Chuck.
Well, you know, there's really a dynamic here that I think needs to be mentioned, and we've alluded to it. I'm not sure we've clarified it as well. And that really has to do with the growth rate, or the rate of change of growth. You know, a faster growing company is going to generate a lot more future cash flow than a slower growing company. And so when you're doing valuation, you know, the part of the process is trying to determine, you know, as Nathan, I think, said, what's a fair price to pay that's going to allow you to, you know, have value in the business, where the business is going to generate the returns you expect, and you're going to get value for that without taking a great deal more risk. The key is to try to align, you know, the returns on your invested capital with what the business is capable as a business, like Bill talked about, generating on your behalf in the future. So to me, you know, it's all about, you know, trying to align yourself so that you can fully participate in what the business is capable of generating on your behalf, and not just looking at the market as a casino. People that tend to be price focused, I think, you know, they don't have all the information they really need to make a rational decision, in my opinion. You've got to marry the two. You've got to try to figure out, hey, approximately what's this business worth? How much can it grow in the future? And what would be a price that I can pay to buy that would still make economic sense to me, the human being, shareholder, partner in that business?
So being price focused tends to be relatively, you know, short-term, short-sighted. And obviously the three of you are the opposite of that. You guys are the long-term buy and hold. So Bill, I wanted to also explore some more reasons for, you know, the reasons to buy and hold a stock and not just hold it in the short term. You know, what is your idea behind why someone should be in the long haul when investing in a stock?
Well, it's been actually proven that over time, the stock market, if you look at it, has gone up. The Standard & Poor's 500 over 20-year periods usually go up and has improved in value and in price and so forth. Emotions, you know, there's a bad day in the market and some people panic and sell. It never seems to pay off. I personally, and I have my own philosophy on this, but the buy and hold has worked well for me because I like to reinvest my dividends even if the market drops. I'm thinking, well, dollar cost averaging, I'm buying a company at a lower price today because the market's down, I'm acquiring more, and in time, the market will go up again. And that has proven a great philosophy for my portfolio over the years.
Could you explain a little bit more about dollar cost averaging and, you know, the concept behind it for the people who don't fully understand what it is or have never even heard of it?
Sure. We're paying so much for so many shares of stock today. As the price, Mr. Market goes up and down and we keep buying, we're buying more shares at a different price. So really it's a weighted cost average of what you're paying for a stock over time. And if you're buying more shares when it drops, oh, that helps your weighted cost average. You know, I look at Apple. It has been a wonderful investment. It's a large part of my portfolio. But Chuck did encourage me and other investors, because the price got so overvalued, to take some money off the table. And I did. I took some money off the table. And I've watched this price go up and down. But I've held a lot of my Apple too. And this is the way I kind of look at it. You great companies that are going to prosper into the future. I want to own, but I'm buying them at different prices as the market goes up and down if I dollar cost average.
And if you don't mind, Colt, I'd like to add to that also. I was given a great metaphor about the benefit of dollar cost averaging. Dollar cost averaging allows you to be aggressive with your money when prices are cheap and defensive when they're expensive, because you're putting in the same amount of money or a similar amount of money if you're reinvesting dividends, for example. And if the market's real high, your money's automatically defensive. You'll buy fewer of the expensive shares. In contrast, if you happen to hit the time when the market is real low, then your money is more aggressively buying more of the cheap stock. So what it does, as Bill pointed out, it averages out your investment over time, and you participate in that, you know, that rise that the markets tend to do over extended periods of time. So it you're defensive when markets are expensive, and you're aggressive when they're inexpensive.
So I do want to also talk about, Bill, you brought up taking some off of the table, you know, harvesting some gains. So when we're starting to get to overvalued territory, and Chuck and Bill, I want you guys to kind of start this conversation off. When we start to get to overvalued territory on a stock, that doesn't necessarily mean, you know, to sell everything off the table, correct? Like, we should maybe trim some of our positions back and still hold on to that company for potential future gains, even if it's overvalued. Or in the case of Apple, do you think we should be getting rid of everything and finding a comparable investment to put that money into? Chuck, why don't you start off with?
Well, when I see a stock get overvalued, I have a rule, my own personal rule. Like Bill said, he has his own philosophy. When I measure a stock, typically utilizing fast graphs, and I see the price is more than 2 years ahead of earnings, that means that, you know, the 2 years of future earnings, it would take more than that, or that at least, before I could justify that value, then I will start to trim. But I don't necessarily do that as just a full reaction. What I typically do is I create a sell watch list, and I start monitoring that stock very carefully. In the meantime, I'm simultaneously looking for maybe comparable companies, and comparable, I mean, have similar growth rates, similar quality characteristics that I can buy at a more attractive valuation, so that I'm attempting to de-risk my portfolio. And, you know, unfortunately, they don't ring a bell at the top or the bottom of the market. At some point, we got to use judgment. And I've taught myself to never have buyers or sellers remorse. You know, the markets can do crazy things over short periods of time. If I made a sound decision, that's all I can ask for. But I do like to, you know, trim. So maybe I'll do a series of trims. Maybe if I find something really compelling, maybe I will sell the whole thing. But it's going to depend on the situation and the opportunity costs or opportunities that I have available at the same time.
Bill, do you have any additional comments on that?
Well, I definitely agree. My wife and I are somewhat conservative. We do hold a lot of money in a short-term corporate bond fund. And, you know, it doesn't pay a lot of money, but we look at this and it's kind of our checking account in a way. It's keeping up with inflation and it's liquidity, and we don't have to worry if we need money, we have it. But, you know, over the long term, we'd like to take our capital and put it to work, have it give us back a return. And, you know, a good investor would like a 15% return if you're taking a risk. It's risk reward. So I love to have a company that can give me back a return. Great companies like Johnson & Johnson or Microsoft. But they do get overvalued, as Chuck said, and maybe that's the time to take some off and put it somewhere else where somebody else is undervalued, and in the long term, it would give you a better return.
You just don't want to do that too often. You know, portfolio is like a bar of soap. The more you handle it, the smaller it gets. But you do need to at least be aware of the overvaluation, so you're aware of the risk you're taking. Sorry, go ahead. Cole.
Bill, were you going to say something?
I was just going to say, you know, I look at our money personally in two areas. We have our SEP IRA and our retirement fund that's tax-free, and I can maybe play with that more without tax consequences. The other part where I'm, you know, if you sell something within a year, your capital gains tax gets up to be 35%. And that's a large portion of your profits. So you have to think about taxes too.
Bill, you brought up something a little bit ago. You mentioned you guys keep a lot of your money in corporate bonds just to keep up with, you said corporate bonds, correct?
It's a short-term corporate bond fund. It's a liquid
So just to keep up with inflation, obviously there's different investments for different reasons. And Nathan, I wanted to talk about the concept of you know, what do you want from your investments and what should someone be expecting from investments? Because not all investments are the same and people need to be making investments for, you know, with specific goals in mind and not necessarily just throwing a dart at the board, for example.
Yeah, it's a great question. We've kind of touched on some of the areas related to this, but I'll give my very finance professor answer and say it's about risk and reward, right? Like, it's what we talk about a lot in finance and investing is, in general, what you want from an investment is a reward that matches the risk you're taking. And, you know, as long as that's a fair trade-off, it's sort of in the basket of possible investments. You just don't want something where you're not getting compensated for taking risk. So just as a big across the board, it doesn't matter what type of investment you're talking about, that needs to be true. And then as far as like the mix of different types of investments, stocks and bonds and real estate and other assets and what an individual wants, I think one of the things that's really cool about taking a more active role in managing your money or helping make those decisions is you get to define what you want. You know, if you want something that's a little less risky, then there's a set of investments that make sense for you. If you're okay with a lot more risk, then maybe a different set of investments would be more appropriate for you. And so the ability to match your own personal goals and your risk tolerance to your overall investment holdings, I think is a really nice thing to have. Just sticking within stocks, you can get wide ranges of risk there too. And it doesn't take a ton of time if you've got the kind of right information and right data to make an assessment on the risk that you're getting. And certainly the current price that we're talking about with, you know, overvaluation is kind of a function of the risk to you as the investor. If you're buying something that might be a little bit ahead of its fundamentals, that means you're probably taking on a little more risk. And we talked about growth, and really needing a lot of growth to come exposes you to some different risks. And so, you know, I think it can be a pretty manageable process to just set a goal and then identify the risks that are out there, figure out what the reward could look like, and then just, you know, use some judgment to make sense of, yeah, that seems like an appropriate return for the risk I'm taking on here.
Chuck, do you have any comments on any of that?
Yeah, and I think Nathan's right on there, but I think you also have to recognize, like I say, it, you know, when I say it's a market of stocks, not a stock market, that often I'm referring to valuation. There's overvalued, undervalued stocks, but you also have to recognize that stocks come in all sizes, shapes, and I guess you say flavors, you know. And so sometimes just investing for a certain goal, this idea that, you know, I'm only investing to make as much money as I can, I believe is a flawed strategy. As Nathan pointed out, risk can be a big factor. You know, so you have certain investments that are focused on income production, for example, yield. And maybe they're high yield investments. You have other ones that might have a lower yield and more growth, as Nathan talked about. And so I think the other thing is to make sure that you're choosing investments amongst all the choices you have just in the stock market alone, let alone fixed income bonds and, you know, other alternative types of investments. You can look at stocks. Some are great income producers. Some are, you know, great growth stocks that pay no dividends. And so you want to make sure that you're designing a portfolio that meets the goals, objectives, and risk tolerances that you need, want, and are comfortable with. And by the way, you know, the amount of money you have, by the way, can be a big determining factor. If you've been diligent and saved all your life and you have a large enough asset base, if you will, you can be even more conservative with that money, take less risk, as both Nathan and Bill talked about, and still generate enough income to meet your needs. If you haven't been as diligent and you've got to get growth, then you've got to try to mix some growth with some income. But there's all different kinds of options. I think the key is to be realistic also on what the market can give you, and then look for common stocks that, you know, fit your goals and objectives. Are they producing enough income? Are they growing that income? Or are they just going to give you an opportunity to grow? And how much risk are you willing to take to achieve any of those goals?
So I think one part of investing that people have trouble with is actually, you know, pulling the trigger and making those investments, actually deploying their cash. Nathan, I believe it was you, we were having a conversation last week, and, you know, the adage goes, it's time in the market, not timing the market. And you brought up an interesting point, something along the lines of, once you miss the momentum, you know, most of the gains are off the table. Could you explain a little bit more of that?
Yeah, that's right. There's different studies that have looked at this, but if you miss the, you know, that's a relatively small number of days where most of the upward price movement exists in these stocks. If you miss those days, then it has a massive impact on the long-term return. And what that says to me is you don't want to be hopping in and out of the market, and you want to keep your cash deployed. And it kind of goes back to the buy and hold and the longer term orientation. If you start thinking you can time and avoid those down moves and time and sell at exactly the right point, that's usually not a real doable thing consistently. And it's much more manageable to stay in, and it's much more rewarding is what the research would show. Is if you happen to be out when those big price movements come, which can be very hard to predict, then you've missed out on a lot of the benefits. So you got to just stay the course. And that's a little counterintuitive. Some folks, when things go down, they kind of want to run. And when things go up, they want to sell. Sometimes that's the reverse of what they should be doing. But sometimes they shouldn't be doing anything. They should just be sticking with it. If the fundamentals have stayed the same, then you don't worry so much about what's going on with the price. It's when something changes fundamentally that you have to start thinking about taking action. And we don't want to get distracted by price movement.
And Bill, do you have any additional comments on that?
Well, I just agree with what Nathan just said. Absolutely. And it's worked well for me. And I think it's worked well for most people that do stay the course and don't panic. The market has good days, bad days, good years, bad years. But over the long term, if we're patient, Nathan said diligent, I think it's going to give us a payback. It's like that snowball going down the hill. We just want to compound with time. And time is our best friend. So start young and stick with it.
So staying the course, I feel like that's easier said than done for most people, if not all people. But I wanted to talk about then, what can the Value You Academy do for people that are signing up for it? Will it help guide them, keep them calm, you know, help them? What exactly is it going to provide for someone that's going to be going through the academy? Chuck, why don't you?
Well, you know, it comes to the old adage, knowledge is power. And, you know, the better you understand what you're doing, the more capable you are of staying the course, the more capable you are of not getting flustered by some, you know, short-term volatility. Of course, we saw a lot of that recently, you know, with when the COVID pandemic originally hit and the markets went through all kinds of volatility. There are stocks that have had incredible, you know, results. Now, there are some companies whose fundamentals were more affected by the pandemic than others, and some of those stocks are still suffering. But, you know, the real reality of it is, you know, knowledge is power. The more you know, the better prepared you're going to be. And what we intend to do in the Value You Academy is we're going to clarify how to look at a company's financial statements, how to analyze a balance sheet, an income statement, a cash flow statement. We're going to talk about things like we talked about today. How do you determine fair value? We're going to make these distinctions between the difference between price and value. And we're going to try to do it in a fun and friendly way. And as Nathan mentioned last week, we're also then simultaneously going to try to provide you the tools that can help you do that so that you can stay the course. You know, there's a geometry about investing that I think really needs to be brought up here. And it really relates to the difference between realized losses and unrealized losses, as an example. And the same goes with gains, realized gains versus unrealized gains. You know, if you take a dollar and it falls to 50 cents, you've got to earn 100% on that money, on the 50 cents you have left to get back to a dollar, even though you only lost 50%. If you take a dollar to 25 cents, you know, you've lost 25%. You got to earn 33 1/3% to get that 75 cents back to a dollar. So, you know, you've got that dynamic that you also want to be careful of. So I think it was Warren Buffett coined the phrase, you know, to win, you must not lose. You want to, first of all, protect money at all costs. And one way to do that is to focus on fundamentals first and recognize that and accept the fact that markets will misappraise stocks from time to time, be able to identify the times when that's happening, whether it's undervaluing it or overvaluing it, and then make appropriate decisions based on the real knowledge of what a business is worth. You know, like I always say, you know, if I knock on your door right now and you own your home and you have an idea of what your home is worth, and I offered you half the value of that home, you'd kick me off your porch. You know, if I offered you three times the value of the home, you might invite me in for coffee and say, let's sit down and talk a little bit. And the key to that is, though, most people have, maybe not with a perfect number, but they know what their home is worth. And you got to know what your stocks are worth as well. That's how you can protect yourself from an often very precarious, you know, and volatile market at times.
Awesome. Thanks for that, Chuck. And Bill, Nathan, do you guys have any closing remarks before we wrap up this video for today?
I think it's a great, great point Chuck just made, you know, and I think investing can seem overwhelming on the surface. There's so many stocks and a lot of advice out there and a lot of writing on it. And I just think that a lot of times folks don't feel very confident in what they're doing. They don't feel very empowered to make decisions. But I think with the right information, that's the goal of Value U Academy, is to give the right background, the right why is huge, but the why is not very useful without the how. And that's really what the FastGraphs platform gives you, is really easy to use, quick to use, easy to understand way of visualizing the things that we talk about, and to put the why and the how together immediately. And I think once folks try it out and see how it fits together, the confidence grows, and then it becomes much easier to stay the course. And it becomes much easier to create your own course and your own path. And the more you go, I think the better it gets and the easier it gets. So I think it really has kind of a virtuous cycle to it. So I'm very excited about the combination of the two.
And Bill, anything from you before we wrap up?
Well, I agree. I'm excited also. And as Chuck said, knowledge is power. And the aha of learning that businesses are pieces, and we can put these pieces together. And when you put the pieces together and see how businesses work, and it's not that complicated, it's not that hard. Are they profitable? Are they generating cash flow? What are they doing with their cash flow? What do their ratios look like? And that, I think, is what Value U is all about, showing you the pieces and how they go together.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys for your time today. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to the YouTube channel. And thanks for watching. See you guys next time.
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Thank you.